What's up, everyone? Manesh, the psychedelic scientist here. I'm a neuroscience PhD student with ongoing research in the field of psychedelic neuroscience. And this is my channel where I share the latest findings and developments in psychedelic science in a way that's easy to understand but not superficial at the same time. So in this video, I'm going to be diving into the entropic brain hypothesis of how psychedelics work. The entropic brain hypothesis was first proposed by leading psychedelic neuroscientist Robin Carhart-Harris back in 2014, and he also published an update to this hypothesis in 2018. So the main idea of this model or hypothesis is that psychedelics makes the brain a bit more entropic in its activity, and this leads the brain and mind to transition from what are called secondary process states to primary process states. And of course, contained with this is the idea that the psychedelic experience can be characterized as a primary process state. So this, of course, leads to questions about like what these terms mean, etc. And in this video, I'm going to be diving into three core ideas which will allow us to unpack what this statement means. First, I'm going to describe what entropy is and how it might relate to our understanding of brain function. Second, I'm going to use that concept of entropy to describe what primary versus secondary consciousness means. And then third, I'm going to dive into a bit more detail on what it means for psychedelics to increase entropy and lead us into primary process state. All right, so the concept of entropy comes from statistical physics and thermodynamics in particular. One way we can understand it is that it indexes the amount of randomness or disorder or unpredictability of a system. Essentially, if a system is more entropic, that means we're more uncertain about what it would look like anytime we observe it at a given point in time. So let me ground this in a concrete example. So let's take as our system a glass of water. And we can understand it as a system of interacting water molecules. And let's say we're interested in the particular location of a specific water molecule. So if we freeze this water and it's pure ice, there's basically no entropy because now we know that water molecule is going to be in the exact same spot if we measure it now or in 5 seconds. And then let's say we melt it and now it's liquid. Now there's a bit more entropy, there's a bit more randomness in the specific location that this water molecule will be in. We're a bit more uncertain about it. And then let's say it boils and evaporates and now it's in gas form. And now that water molecule can be anywhere in the room, so now it's even more entropic. So again, we can understand entropy as indexing the degree to which a particular property of a system is disordered, random, and unpredictable. So now let's think of this in terms of the brain. So if we think about the brain, it makes sense that it can't be totally entropic. Because if everything was chaotic and disordered and random, our experience would just be crazy all the time. At any given moment, anything could go, there'd be no stability or orderliness, and we would just be in crazy panic chaos all the time. And so it's reasonable to postulate that the brain has to minimize entropy and keep it within a constrained range in order for us to be able to navigate our lives in any effective and stable manner. So basically, a core idea of the entropic brain theory is that in normal waking consciousness, part of the brain is actively suppressing the entropy of other parts of the brain, and this is what allows us again to have this stable experience of the world. Robin Carhart-Harris also proposes that entropy might relate to the informational richness of our experience. If our experience was the equivalent of an ice cube, not much going on and there's not much information there. Whereas if we're in gas form in terms of our experience and we can enter so many different states and we have this unconstrained, you know, space to change our properties and move into different locations, then we could say there's more information there. It's a bit more rich. So to put this whole thing into these terms is the idea that part of the brain is suppressing the other parts of the brain in order to reduce entropy and keep the complexity and informational richness of our experience in a range that's a bit limited such that we're able to navigate our lives effectively and not be overwhelmed. And to foreshadow what I'll talk about later, the idea is that the default mode network is involved in this entropy suppression, and that psychedelics, by disrupting default mode network activity, are kind of taking the brakes off the entropy in our brain and leading us into these more chaotic and disordered and random states. But before I get to that, let me just talk about what primary versus secondary consciousness mean. First, I should mention that Carhart-Harris didn't come up with these terms. They actually originate in Sigmund Freud and his metapsychology, or his theory of the structure of the mind. Basically, the short story is that primary process consciousness is the consciousness or state of mind that occurs when there's no entropy suppression. And this type of consciousness is described as hyper-associative, where everything seems to be connected to everything. It often features illogical and contradictory thought. It features a merging of images and is very visual and imagistic in character. It can sometimes be characterized by extreme and rapid changes in emotion, and also feature random or abrupt transitions between thoughts that don't really make any sense. And in contrast to this is secondary process consciousness. And this is a type of consciousness that's very logical, constrained, rule-based, analytical, realistic, rational, and all the rest. Basically, it's our normal waking state of consciousness as humans. And so basically, again, the entropic brain hypothesis is saying that our ability to primarily inhabit secondary consciousness states in our day-to-day is a result of the advanced development of our brain and our default mode network in particular. And then we can see how primary consciousness states can be accessed through various altered states of consciousness and also mental health conditions such as in psychosis. As an interesting aside, you might also be thinking that primary consciousness sounds like it might be conducive for creativity. And as a little shameless plug, I actually argue that this might be the case in a recently published paper. All right, let's come full circle to what I started this video off with. So basically, the primary idea underlying the entropic brain hypothesis is that one, that the psychedelic state can be described or characterized as primary process consciousness, and that two, psychedelics put us into primary consciousness by increasing the entropy of our brain activity. So now let's just get a little bit more specific and nuanced in what exactly it's saying about the brain. So what this model or hypothesis is specifically saying is that the entropy that produces primary process states is actually related to specific parts of the brain called the medial temporal lobes. So the medial temporal lobes are, as described, a medial part of the temporal lobes, and actually include core memory regions such as the hippocampus and parahippocampus. These are regions involved in various forms of memory, and particularly interesting for the present context, they seem to be involved in generating or creating the spontaneous thoughts and daydreaming episodes that we have throughout our day. And they're also very involved in associative thinking, so making associations between concepts. And so the idea is that when these regions become more entropic, that leads to primary process states. Usually in our normal consciousness, the default mode network is suppressing these regions. So essentially what this is postulating is that the default mode network is an evolved, more advanced aspect of our brain that is suppressing and controlling and constraining these lower, more primitive areas. And through this suppression, through this entropy suppression and constraint on memory activity, we're then able to access these secondary process states, which again are more stable, rule-based, logical, predictable, etc. And so the specific idea in terms of the brain underlying the entropic brain hypothesis is that psychedelics disrupt the default mode network's activity and connectivity, and this then reduces the amount of constraint it's putting on these lower areas, and then these lower areas become more entropic and share all this memory information with the rest of the brain. And this puts us into so-called primary process states. Now, there is a good amount of empirical research supporting that something like this might be going on, but there's still a lot of stuff that isn't really proven yet or not really known. Diving into the details of this is really fascinating, but it's totally beyond the scope of this video, and it'll get very nuanced and technical really fast. But if you're curious and you want to hear a more in-depth critique of it, I can make a whole nother video on it, and please let me know in the comments. So one last thing I want to say in this video is that more recently, Robin Carhart-Harris proposed a new model of psychedelics called the Relaxed Beliefs Under Psychedelics, or REBUS model, which includes the entropic brain theory within it and builds on that into a larger framework. And so in my next video, I'm going to be diving into that model and describing how the entropic brain relates to it. So be on the lookout for that. And with that, thank you so much for watching this video. Show me some love and hit that like button and subscribe if you haven't already for more videos on the latest in psychedelic science.